Oh, yeah. Diddy got a podcast.
You and I share something. And what we share is being two intellectual, so-called black men who come from disenfranchised, underserved communities, essentially what people call the hood.
Yeah.
You said something to me that I've never heard someone say before out loud, but I've always felt it, which is it can be uncomfortable to be an intelligent so-called black man in certain environments, mm-hmm. certain settings.
Yep.
And you don't quite know how other people are going to take it.
Yep.
Could you speak to that just a little bit for me?
Yeah. So, you know, what I was getting at is, you know, I would say I would study. I would be doing my study work and, you know, reading, doing clinical school work. And I would catch myself, you know, trying to figure out when I was safe to be or to do that.
Wow, man.
You know, like, what space is safe for me to truly be an intellectual black man? Because as a heterosexual, cisgender black male growing up, you know, you see throughout your history book a few people that were intellectual black men and they spoke to different issues. What happened to those intellectual men? You can feel me in. They were assassinated, you know, just for saying, this is how I feel. Not saying that, oh, if this don't happen, I'm going to kill somebody. Or not saying that, oh, you know, I'm going to, you know, do this to the next person if this doesn't. Just for saying, hey, you know, this is where I stay. And that's how I feel about where I stay.
Right.
That's how I feel about the state of where I stay.
This is what I recognize. This is what I realize.
That's it. You know, analyzing, you know, their environment. That's all they were doing. You know, so they were verbally assassinated for essentially doing that. Whether that was agreeing or disagreeing with the right or wrong people, they both end up assassinated. You know, so it's just kind of like, I remember as a high school boy sitting in the back of class. As soon as we got in class, I want to sit in the back. You know, and it's just kind of like, well, it probably was a few guys that sit in the front, but it wasn't me. You know, so we learned this pattern early, you know, of denouncing our intelligence. You know, I'm sitting in the back of class like, you know, I want to sit in the back. Even though I probably know all the answers to these questions, I'm going to sit in the back and answer them and not in the front and answer them. You know, because I want to always have that distance away from knowledge and away from understanding.
You don't want to offend people. You don't want to overstep.
Exactly. You don't want to overstep. You know what I'm saying? So even when I would do my clinic work, I would ask my girl. I would find myself asking my girl like, hey, I'm going to study. That's cool. Hey, I'm going to read this book. That's cool. Because I, even in the midst of an intimate relationship, I don't know when it's safe to be an intellectual black male. Wow. So with that, you know, that's just kind of what I was getting at, you know, and it's just kind of like, you know, today, you know, who's speaking on these issues? You know, who's brave enough to step to the front, you know, with the historical reference of it, you know, so it's just kind of like, and also who's funding intellectualism? You get what I'm saying? Like, it's no, you know, if it's no, right. Like I said, we talked about the bag. There's no bag in the intellectualism.
Like, there's a bag in, like, such as, like, the rap community. Like, you'll put that bag behind that rapper because he broke, but he talented. We can put that bag behind him, and he going to take all of us somewhere. There's no bag behind the intellectualism.
But rap is also intellectualism.
It can be, absolutely.
It can be. Right. It started off being intellectualism. But over
I'm glad you said that.
Yeah, but over time, it has denounced itself to words. You know, so it's just kind of like, you know, and then you get to the point, you know, I'm gonna go even deeper. Is it attractive to be an intellectual black male? You get even deeper. I'm gonna get intimate here. Is it attractive,
man? I'm trying to get you up off of this podcast in time, Tim.
Essentially, if I plan to, you know, raise a household and do the things that I want to do, is it attractive? You know, what do I tell my son, you know, when he go to school and somebody say, call him a geek or call him a nerd? What do I tell him? Because I can empower him, but 80% of what he's been raised by is from 8 o'clock in the morning to 3:45 in the evening. So it's kind of like, what do I tell him? You feel me? So it's just kind of like, I know a lot of guys that I went to high school with wore saggy pants, had waves, earrings, looked like the stereotypical, you know, whatever you want to call it.
Right.
But they were very intelligent. You know what I also, and they didn't necessarily have a lot of people around them, but more so they did not have a lot of women around them. And I never understood that dynamic. I never understood it. And it was like they seemed more disciplined than the regular, you know? They seemed more focused. I'm just like, wow, like I know I'm that too, but I ain't gonna show that. You know what I'm saying?
Just to make sure I'm understanding you correctly and make sure the listeners are understanding you correctly. Are you saying those, the gentlemen who did not show their intelligence were not around women?
No, it goes back to the question I'm asked. Is it attractive?
Is it attractive
and
to be
in and I'm not just saying to women, but to society.
Right.
But to the school system. Is this path that has been taken by so many other people in this world throughout history, is it beneficial for me to even take it? Because I've seen what has happened to, you know, black males that also pursued this route. You know, Carver Washington, you know, was castrated by his adopted family. You know, he lived his life with, you know, no,
I didn't know that,
sexual reproduction. So if you hear his voice is extremely high pitched. But you know that Washington was one of the most intellectual people of our time. So the things that we do today, like the plant, we call it the plant because it was created, you know, not just a warehouse, but it was something that he created by cross-pollination of plants. And Henry Ford got low to what he was doing with the plants and say, hey, can you introduce me to that same kind of schedule of idea of thought to my mass production of cars? And so you get this cross-pollination of intellectualism. But the question of Washington, a lot of his career was, is he straight? Is he homosexual? Because his voice was extremely high pitched, but they removed his testicles as a child because they didn't want him to reproduce with the other woman that was, he's raised by a white family. They didn't want him to reproduce with the other. You can go look this up. This is factual knowledge. I wouldn't say nothing that wasn't factual. So it's kind of like, do I really want to pursue that? You know, and I have so many different thoughts about different things, and you know, people are like, oh, you get a podcast, bro. Oh, get a YouTube. Should I? You know,
I seen you ask that question on social media, by the way.
Yeah,
I couldn't tap yes so many times.
Yeah, yeah, like, you know, and you know, so I'm looking at it, you know, from that angle as well. So, yeah, that intellectualism, you know, is it a determining path, or is it just, you know, something to do?
Wow, something I've asked myself a lot, because we all know who gets the attention most times. What it seems, and I don't want to offend any women, what it seems like a lot of women seem to be more attracted to, as opposed to an intellectual, not just an intellectual so-called black man, intellectual male in general, but especially intellectual so-called black man, because that don't seem to always cut it. That don't seem to always be what's hip.
Yep.
So man, I'm so glad you touched on that.